Hello everyone, thanks for being here with us, attending this talk. My name is Patrick Tiziano, this is Alexandre Bellon. We are two engineers from a French embedded Linux consulting company called Belibre. And the purpose of our talk today is some non-intrusive power and performance debugging library, or framework I should say. We believe there's no better introduction than a demo. So let's start directly with demo. So just to get you started. So what do you see here? First, it's actually a two-in-one demo. It's going to be difficult to see, but if you were there yesterday at the technical showcase, our teammate Neil demonstrated a completely upstream hardware-accelerated video decoding. So it's all software, all upstream software running on a potato board, so on an AM Logic platform. So here you just have video playback running. And what we do here is that what you see here on the screen is actually a real-time visualization of the CPU load as well as the CPU bus accesses. So this is the CPU load of the four cores. And this is the memory accesses done by the four cores. The refresh rate is 10 Hertz, but it could be higher. And this is to prove you that it's real hardware acceleration, because the load is less than 10% in average. So if there was some software decoding, that would be way much higher. You may argue, well, okay, it's just another visualization, CPU load visualization tool. Yeah, but it has some little magic. First thing is that it's non-intrusive. There's no application running on the target, and we are not altering the CPU execution flow. And it's done in real time, and it's OS agnostic. So, and it's multi-architecture, which means that this application may run on different boards than this one and for different applications. We have made no single changes or modification in the code running on the target. And that's pretty awesome. The sampling rate may go way higher, and still we will be able to display it without any artifact on the board. So the purpose of our talk now is to explain you. Yes, thank you. To explain you why we believe in that, why we've done that, and how. Okay, so what's the problem? When your job is to do power and performance analysis, debugging, optimization, you have to have tools that has the following requirements. You have to do non-intrusive access to your platform. You should not be invasive, and you should not alter the way the platform is running. Otherwise, it's not you are seeing something that is not exactly the truth, and that's not what you want. So you don't want to interrupt the CPU execution flow, and you also don't want to alter the power states of the various peripherals in your SoC, because that's exactly what you want to see. You want to see when the peripheral is active or when it is not. Another thing for us human beings is that we really do enjoy having a visualization of whatever is happening in the SoC. And to do that in real time, we need some tools that do that. But combining this requirement with being non-intrusive is already a challenge. Next requirement we want is that we don't want to do that only on a single platform, on a single SoC, in a single use case. We want to be as generic as possible, so support many different OS on the target and on the host PC, and also support many different architectures. And obviously, we want all this to be open source. So maybe anyone in the audience can tell me a name of a tool that fulfills all those requirements. Okay, yeah, that's what I guess. There's none. Why? Well, there are many reasons for that. There are technical challenges, obviously. But today, we have really great tools embedded in the Linux kernel that helps us profile application executions. But it's running on the target. It's, I would say that impact on the target is limited, but it's still there, and it's also blind when you do a power transition in the CPU. What we want, what we ultimately want to do is that even if the CPU cores are asleep, we can still see what's happening on the platform in those sleep modes. Also, many tools may share data to the host over USB, UART, the console, or Ethernet. And this is just altering the use case. It's no more the same use case. So we don't have such tool today. So what we want to improve here? First, we want everything to run on a host so that it will be non-intrusive and there is no code to rebuild or to add on the target. There would be no compilation flag to switch. It's just the target code is running on its own. Well, we want to have something modular and flexible and scalable so that we can write as many applications as we can think of without every time reinventing the wheel. And one thing that we want to improve is also to have something that describes what's inside the SOC in a software programmable way. So somehow some sort of reference manual, but in software. This is the only way doing so. This is the only way to have generic software that could support different platforms. So here, this last bullet is really just an analogy with what Device Tree has brought to the Linux kernel. If you remember the time before Device Tree, we would have to write C code to support every single board. And now, thanks to Device Tree, well, we just write a single driver and it adjusts with the different base address and other settings. Okay, and here is libsoca to save the world. What are the main features of this famous libsoca? Well, libsoca enables to have to make generic, non-intrusive access to the to any register or memory of a chip, and this will be done over JTAG. And we'll explain further later. Libsoca also helps at abstracting architectures thanks to SVD files that we'll also describe later. It's some sort of a DTS file, if you want. Libsoca is OS agnostic, and by this we mean both on the target and on the host, because everything is written in Python. You may find the source code following those links and the documentation following this link. Why JTAG? This is the only solution we have today to make non-intrusive register accesses, as simple as that. It's also great because it supports hardware, or software breakpoints and watch points, which helps also being able to be to develop applications that are event-based and not only based on polling. JTAG is supported by almost any board, at least in the development phase, and SoCs. And we can manage it thanks to some software library called OpenOCD. SVD files stands for System View Description files. It describes the SOC typically. So in those files, it's XML based, and typically it follows the hierarchy of the SOC. So you would have a description of the device, the peripherals, and the registers, and the bit field. And for all of these elements, you will have all the details, like if you were reading a reference manual. Here are some examples for you. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it, but you have the name of the device, the name of the vendor, if it's a 32-bit or 64-bit architecture, and many other details. That's for a description of device. Now, if we look at the description of a peripheral, so it's a RNG, so random number generator. So it's an IP, a peripheral inside the SoC. And we have its base address, the number of registers, and the descriptions of the registers are then following here. So it's very easy because you can parse this very easily. Python has everything for you. And then you can start thinking about, hey, wait, maybe I can now access my registers no more by values, so by address with X values, but by name. And not only that, but I can also read and alter a given bit field by name, no more by address. So I don't have to do some print k trace to get the X value of the register and read into my documentation what it means. It's direct. And now I let Alex describe a little bit more the architecture.
So first we have the board itself. So on the board we must have a JTAG obviously to use it. So usually we are using JTAG for one thing. It's to stop, to alter the CPU, to do step debugging, things like that, and to see the memory. Here we are not going to use it in that way. We just want to access to the memory, but we don't want to stop the CPU. So instead of connecting JTAG to the CPU access point, we are explicitly asking to the JTAG to connect to the memory access point. In that way, we are able to access to many registers, many things, without the need to stop the CPU and to use it to do the access. So to connect JTAG to the computer, you need a JTAG emulator. So here we don't need a specific emulator. Any emulator supported by OpenCD could work. So for the demo, we are using G-Link, but actually any other emulator, even non-expensive and cheap, could work. So we are using OpenCD as a telnet server. Same as the UGC tag on the target. Most of the time, OpenCD is used as a GDB server. So we run it and we just stop the CPU and start to use to do things with the CPU. Here again, we are using OpenCD differently. So we use it to connect to the memory access point, and we just using Telnet send some basic commands to read or write things in the memory or in the registers. We are using a library wrote in Python that abstracts all the Telnet protocol. On top of that, there is a Lipsoka. So the goal of the Lipsoka is to abstract as much as possible all of that. We don't want, actually we are using JTAG, but we don't want to be stuck with JTAG. So if we want, if we adapt the JTAG abstraction layer, we could eventually support any other medium. We still prefer to use JTAG because it's the only one that will be non-intrusive, but JTAG is not always available. So it may be good sometime to use something else. So this layer will help to do that. On top of that layer, we have the device register access layer. The goal of this layer is to provide an easy way to make access to the registers. I'm quite lazy as a developer, and I don't like to every time to have to remember the offset of the registers, to do bit offset, to bit shifting, sorry. I don't want to manipulate the bit. So what I did, I made abstraction in order to be able to write directly to the bit field. So if I just want to write one bit in the register, I just take the name of the register, dot the field name, and then I write the value. And same to get the value from the register. And the layer will take in charge all of that and will transform everything in a JTAG command. So once we have done that, there is nothing else to do. And all of that rely on SVD files. So as Patrick explained, SVD files describes the SoC. So it provides the list of the peripherals, the list of registers, the fields, and using all of that information, we could just create a tree of peripherals, registers, fields, and automatically compute the bit offset if we want to set a bit and things like that. It's all of that is possible thanks to SVD files. And on top of that, we are providing many subsystems and SoC files. So for the subsystems, we have currently with only two subsystems, clock and PMU. So the goal is to provide something generic enough to be used by applications. We thought to have to deal with specific anything related to one SOC or another one. So the goal of the subsystem is really to abstract that. So, and we have the architecture files, which are the place where we write some kind of drivers for a specific SoC. So basically, for the PMU, I wrote PMU drivers that work both on ARM7 and ARM8. And I just have, for the SoC I want to debug using this PMU, just have to instantiate the ARM PMU driver. And on top of that, there is many other layers. If you want just to get the CPU load, we have a perf subsystem that abstracts all the ARM stuff. And on the top, obviously, there is the application we want to write. So donc, as I said, currently we are only supporting clock and PMU, but we are planning to add many other subsystems as we have many crazy ideas, things we'd like to do. About the architecture, as the project is quite young, we only started it a couple of months ago, there is not a lot of architecture. So we are only supporting the PMU for ARM7 and 8. The SoC, we are supporting 1M logic, 1 NXP, and 1 STM. But actually, that's only the one I tried. It would be quite easy to add support of other SoC from the same family. As everything is described as a Python class, we would just have to derive the class to inherit, and just to customize the things that change from one chip to another one. So that will be quite easy to, that will be easy to add many other SoC. So we have started to write applications. This is still in progress. So we have already seen the PMU graph. So PMU graph is a tool to see the CPU load, not only, but the idea is just to have a small tool to display one or more PMU event or perf event. So it supports any event exposed by the ARM PMU subsystem. It's real time, so it's non-intrusive. So about the overhead. So as I said, for the CPU, no overhead because we don't stop the CPU. So I don't know if you were able to see the screen when I show it, but we were able to display to run a 4K video decoding. And it was fluent, no bug on the screen. So, no impact on the CPU. And the interconnect, it's negligible because it's about 500 bytes per second if we are using a sample of 10 Hz. If we want to increase a little the sample rate, doesn't use much more, a lot more of bandwidth. I mean, for 100 Hz, sorry, for 100 Hz, it would be about 5 kilobytes, which is negligible if we compare to the capacity of the interconnect, or if we compare even to the speed of the JTAG. With the default speed we are using on this board, which is 4 megahertz, we could up to 500 kilobytes of data per second. And everything is already on GitHub. On GitHub and GitLab. We moved recently, we made the migration. So now it's on GitLab. We also wrote a tool, a simple tool to just read and write the memory or the registers. So what is nice with this tool is, again, we can use the register's name. So I don't have to remember the offset of the register I want to read. I just need to know his name, which is nice. So, and in addition of the register itself, we can also get the bit field of the register. So we can get the details, and it's really nice. It makes things easier. And further, we are planning to add some features using the watch points to monitor some change of registers. So if we want to see why, what value take a register when it change, we could set up the monitor and just see the value every time it change, things like that. Again, this is also available on GitLab. Still in development, but most of the basic features are here. We're also working on the clock tools. These tools is, the main feature of this tool is to display a clock summary. Actually, quite similar to the one we could get using CFS with the kernel. The goal is not to replace the clock summary we could get using the kernel. It's more to do things that we could do not with the kernel. By example, if we are going, if the CPU is going in some low power state, then we could run any command on the command line. We could not run any command on the CPU, so we can get the state of the clock in this low power state. But with using JTAG, we don't have this issue. If JTAG is still up when we are in this low power state, you could read the registers of the clocks and then show the new state of the clock in this low power state. And in addition, this also works on something else as Linux. I mean, we could use it with Zephyr. Actually, the first time I did it, it was on STM32. So I've been able to get a clock summary on STM32, which is not possible using Zephyr. It doesn't have such a feature as the kernel. This is still in development. Currently, it's not yet on GitLab, but it should be there soon.
Yeah. One last application or example of application, and this is really something I can't wait to have and to use, is some sort of application that would be able to, in one point, show us everything. The power states of the various peripherals inside the SoC, but also the power consumption, the CPU load, everything. We may have such tools available today, but it's different tools. I have one tool to measure power. I have one tool to trace execution. I have one tool to visualize CPU loads. I have one tool for the clock tree and everything. But now I want everything in a single one because you know that we need to see everything in sync to understand the causes and the consequences of different changes. So the idea of this profiling tool, we haven't named it yet, is integrate in a single tool the collection of SOC power states, clock states, power measurements using another external power measurements tool like ACME that Belibre is developing. And we put that in a single window, in a single application. Think about an oscilloscope application where all the various charts is actually one data from the EDSOC. And that would have the basic and I would say the regular features we all want, like being able to start, stop, freeze, and resume data collection, being able to zoom in and out in the various charts, save and reload those traces, but also export to different formats. And finally, also, we would like to have some sort of command line interface so that we could further integrate that tool into some other already existing tool, like, for instance, a continuous integration loop. Obviously, this development hasn't started yet, but we'll do it as soon as possible. And now, Alex will present you how easy it can be to develop application for Lipsoka.
Yeah. So here are just some example of. It's a way to enable the ARM PMU counter. So everything in the Lipsoka is coming from a device. So you have a device, which is the root of the class, all the class we have. And in this device, you have all the peripherals. And then in the peripherals, you can get access to the registers. And then you can do write to the registers. And here, I don't use the bit field because it was more convenient to use to do the bit shift, because I want to dynamically enable one counter, I have to do that. But if I wanted to specifically enable the counter zero, I just would have had to add dot P zero, which is the name of the bit for the counter zero. So everything is met in that way. All the drivers are trying to do everything like that, which is quite easy to read, to write, and it's quite generic because in the case of the ARM PMU, there is some differences between ARM 7 and ARM 8. Some registers are 32 bits. Some of them are 64 bits. But here, we don't really care the SVD. We just say, here, it's 32 bits. So we will send to JTAG, read or write 32 bits. And if it was on ARM 8, 64 bit, same, it would have detected it and then send the write size. Another higher level of so here is just another example of how to use the PMU. So again, we get the PMU from the device. We get the counter we want to use. This one is the one for the CPU cycles. And then we enable the counter, we enable the PMU, and we can read the value from the PMU. And another example, here, if we don't want to, here is more if you want to add ARM PMU to your SOC, to your SOC, sorry. So again, you can get the PMU using the device. Then here we do an instance of the ARM CPU load. So this class will abstract the way to compute the CPU load. It actually we just use this counter, take the frequency of the CPU, and compute using that the CPU load. So everything is abstracted, and we just have to call get value to get the CPU load. And higher level, actually, that's what we are using in the PMU graph application. So if we want just to get the CPU load, as an example, we get some perf event. We get them for each CPU, and then we just have, again, to get to use the get value to get the value for, from the CPU load event. So there is many way to do it. Python is quite, Python is awesome. You can do many things, the same thing in many ways. Some are easy, some are less easy, some are more generic. So it's just short example of what we could do. So while I was working on these tools, I got a couple of issues. First with JTAG itself, because it's easy to find documentation up to that explain how to stop the CPU or to debug the CPU. When it comes to the MEM access point, to do something else than debugging the CPU, there is not a lot of documentation. The CoreSec documentation is quite complete, but there is a lot of information, too much. And again, it's hard to find what we want. Another thing is that SoC doesn't have the same features for debugging. I mean, some features are implementation defined, so they may change from another from SoC from another one. As example, PMU graph is working fine with the IMU logic SoC, but I could not use it with OMAP3 because OMAP3 doesn't have the PMU memory mapped, so I can't access it using JTAG. If I want to get data from PMU, I have to stop the CPU and to use the CP15 coprocessor. Another issue is with the ZD files. So they are not always easy to find. Some SoC vendors give them, no issue. Some use their own format, so we have to convert the files to SVD, which is not a big issue. And some doesn't give anything. And here, when it's the case, we have to write one, which is quite painful and not very interesting. But if we want to use the tools, sometimes we have to do it. And there is no way to include one SVD from another one, which could be an issue when we start to write we own SVD. I will take an example. And the SVD from the SoC vendor doesn't have anything to describe the ARM PMU. So if we want to get the description, if we want to have the PMU in the SVD, we have to include it to the SVD. So currently it's not supported, so I wrote a tool that merge a small SVD file that only describes the PMU with the SoC with the SVD we got from SoC, we merge them, and then we can start to use the SVD and get access to the PMU. So got many issues with OpenCD. It's quite good tools, but it's not easy to set up sometimes. So sometimes when the chip is supported, nothing to do, and sometimes you get many warnings, some errors, things like that. And there is not always a lot of documentation that explain how to fix it, how to make it work, your chip. And also got some issue with the ARM7 and ARM8. When I tried to, first I've been working on the ARM7 to do the PM graph tools. And when I tried to do the same thing on the IMU logic SoC, which is ARM8, I got crashes from the OpenOCD tools. I had to read the source code and to understand why and to finally figure out I was not doing things like it was expected. But it was not documented, so it, yeah. And on the top of OpenCD, I'm using a library in Python that controls OpenCD using Telnet, which is good, except that it requires a lot of process to convert the text to some data, to in, to value, things like that. And in the case of watch points or breakpoints, we are receiving events, asynchronous events, and is not correctly managed by this library. I tried to manage it, to inherit the library and to manage it, but still not good job. So I'm planning to write a new library that will use the server API, which have been introduced quite recently in OpenOCD, instead of Telnet. And now,
thanks, Patrick. So yeah, so what's next? So this is where we are. We described almost everything we had. And what do we plan next? So these are many things we have in mind. They are not prioritized, so the order is not the order of priority. But this is what we could think of and what we want. So first, we want to enable watch point and breakpoint support. This is very important for profiling applications. We want to avoid being able we want to avoid having to poll for data. You know that when polling, you may miss some transitions, so this is not really acceptable. We want to integrate some CI frameworks, so to start doing some regression testing. For instance, we could track some key settings and key performance indicators that would be collected by some Libsoka app and saved by the CI framework. We want also to make Libsoka re-entrant, so we want to enable concurrent use of the library. It is not the case today. As usual, we want to start writing documentation for Libsoka. We want to support, obviously, more SoCs, more subsystems, more IPs, and obviously also build the all the craziest and smartest apps, debugging apps we can think of. Okay, it is time for conclusion. So here are a few things to keep in mind when we will end this call and return home. JTAG really offers a unique solution for non-intrusive real-time monitoring tools. It is extremely powerful, and actually it's not used to the, it's underused, I would say, today. As Alex explained, we use it today just for regular step-by-step debugging, whereas there are other purposes like the one we just explained. Other thing is that maybe it was it's new to you, but those SVD files are very important to enable writing multi-architecture generic software. Libsoka is a very innovative software framework which helps developing generic debugging apps on top of JTAG, SVD files, but also over other medium if JTAG is not available. PMU Graph is a first demo app, pretty basic, but just here to show the to demonstrate the potential. And we count on you to develop the smartest apps possible. Thank you very much, and it is now time maybe for some questions if we are not too late. Any questions? Yes?
How would you handle multi-processors in
a
CPU?
So, how what?
How would you handle more than one CPU? 4 core, 5 core?
Well, it's already the case, the application. If you can toggle back to the demo, if it still runs. Yes, you have the 4 cores. So it's There's some kind of discovery mechanism. So we have those SVD files that describes how many ARM clusters, how many CPU cores you have. And so your application may just get that information and create as more charts as needed.
Yeah, in the SVD files, there is a 4 PMU instance that been described in the files. So we just, for this SOC, instantiate 4 ARM PMU driver, and then we can get the PMU for all the CPU.
Okay, can we use this framework with CPUs that doesn't have PMU, like Cortex-M0? For example, STM-L0. You said you support F4, but if I want to go lower, L4.
Yeah, I didn't write yet the support for the F4. The PMU is quite different, but yeah, it's something that could be done. The only things with this, the PMU of the Cortex-M, it just, you know, it's overflow quite quickly. So we have to poll quite often to avoid to get the, to have an overflow. But yeah, it could use the same mechanism, so.
Yeah, really the idea is it's a framework and it gives you access to all the registers. And well, here we have developed a first code for the Cortex PMU. For M0, it's a different one, so that would be new code. That's all.
Another thing for the Cortex-M family, I think it would be more appropriate to use the watch point for that, because we could program the watch point to generate an event when there is an overflow on this counter, and then we don't have an event to poll. We could just wait for the event and then increase the counters on the software, the host.
Thank you. Any other question, please? Okay. Okay, thank you very much for coming.